A very good afternoon to everybody who's joining me today live on Facebook. The topic I've selected today is mind your diet in pregnancy. The reason I've selected this topic is it serves as a ready reckoner for me, because the most often asked question of every pregnant woman who comes to me is what do we eat? What are the dietary changes that we need to make now since we are pregnant? So I think I'm just going to be giving you pointers which are very easy to follow. You can even make notes if you wish, and we'll get straight on with our topic. Now, first of all, why are we concerned about diet and pregnancy? The most important thing women are worried about is that, we gain a lot of weight during pregnancy. Should we gain this much kgs, or we should gain less, or what? How much to gain, how much to lose, whether we are the right weight. So most importantly, how do you decide if you are in a healthy weight zone? So if your body mass index is between 18.5 to 25, then you are in a healthy BMI zone. Now, what is a BMI? BMI is a body mass index, which means your weight in proportion to your height approximately adds up to what your body mass index is. There are a lot of apps available. So if you just download one of those apps, you will easily be told what your BMI is. All you need to do is enter your weight and enter your height. For that, you'll need to measure your weight and measure your height. So if you do this, you'll know what your BMI is. And ideally, for a healthy pregnancy, it should be between 18.5 to 25. Now, there are some women who do this and then they say that, okay, my BMI is more than 25, so I do not want to be obese, and can I start dieting during pregnancy? So just to let you all ladies know, dieting is a strict no-no during pregnancy. We do not want you to diet. The reason behind that is that you might start restricting your calories a bit too much. It might compromise the nutrition, the balance between the macronutrients, micronutrients in your body. And at a time when you are already in a stressful time physiologically, you have a life developing inside you, we would definitely recommend that you do not diet during pregnancy in terms of calorie restriction. Now, the other most important question is, what are the important supplements or nutrition things that you should consume during pregnancy? Now, why this is important is because nutrition and proper nutrition is essential for the development and growth of the baby. At the same time, it is responsible to make sure that you are able to go through your pregnancy without problems, with an ideal weight, with all the nutrition that you require for sustaining your own body. So it is a double responsibility that nutrition has to be assuming at this journey in our lives. Now, what are those important supplements? The most important one, which most of us will be aware of, is folic acid. Normally, when you go for your first antenatal appointment, or you miss your period first, or if you're planning a pregnancy, your doctor will ask you to go on something called as a folic acid. Now, folic acid is nothing but a kind of a B group vitamin, B complex vitamin. And why it is important in pregnancy is because when the baby is developing, in the early stages of development, the notochord develops. So when this notochord is developing, folic acid is required. There are a lot of neural tube defects that could come in if we do not have adequate levels of folic acid in the body. Now, because of this, we always advise that you take a supplement of folic acid. For example, if you are having thalassemia, or if you have a sickle cell abnormality, that is the time when perhaps the folic acid that you're taking will not only benefit your baby, but it's also going to have a positive effect on your blood cell production. So folic acid, that's why, is always advised. We come to the next vitamin, which is vitamin D. Vitamin D3, which is the activated form of vitamin D. This is important. There are many times we give supplements of vitamin D during pregnancy, but because an excess dose of vitamin D can sometimes cause toxic effects, we would want to do your blood levels of vitamin D before we prescribe a vitamin D supplement. Normally, vitamin D is made in the body from cholesterol that we have when you're exposed to rays of the sunlight, early morning sunlight. But because nowadays most of our lifestyle is such that we do not wake up in those early hours, most of the times we are homebound, we do not go out a lot. If we do go out, it's in a car, we are in air conditioned environments, so vitamin D production in the body is not optimum or not as much as we require, which is why to supplement vitamin D would be a good choice, especially if you're obese. Your body's requirement of vitamin D will be that much higher, and hence women who are slightly on the heavier side would definitely need to have a vitamin D supplement. Coming to the next vitamin, which is vitamin C. Lots is being talked about vitamin C, especially in the current COVID scenario. Vitamin C, definitely it will help you with your skin and collagen and all these other things. It also has a positive impact on your immunity. But in pregnancy, vitamin C becomes more important, not because of all of this, but because it will help your body to absorb the iron from your diet. So hence, vitamin D could be taken along with iron to maximize the absorption of iron. Not independently, unless you are having some kind of other problems. Vitamin K supplements are normally not required for a mother during pregnancy because adequate amounts are normally found. But two babies, because one, when they are newly born, the vitamin K production has not yet started. So we might need to supplement, or most of the times we do supplement babies with vitamin K soon after their birth, along with their immediate vaccination. The most important supplement in terms of our continent, the Indian subcontinent, most of our women, due to dietary habits or due to helminthic infections, are found to be deficient in iron. Because of which most of us women in our country suffer from iron deficiency anemia. Now, why I'm mentioning iron deficiency anemia particularly? Because only if your iron deficiency has led to the anemia will iron supplementation help you. If you have another kind of anemia, which is, let's say, thalassemia, or an anemia due to liver problems or some other problems, then iron supplementation will not cure the anemia. In fact, it can have an adverse effect. So before you start taking iron supplementation, you must be sure that it definitely is an anemia which is due to iron deficiency. So this is a very important concept. Most people think that whenever there's an anemia, you need to supplement with iron. But it's not always a rule of the thumb, and there has to be some investigation before we put you on iron in order to take care of your anemia. So in our country, normally women are checked. Their hemoglobins are checked. From the kind of red blood cells that they have, we can tell if it's an iron deficiency anemia, folate deficiency, or B12 deficiency anemia. Depending on the deficiency, we could then ask you to take oral iron supplementation. Normally these are started after 3 or 4 months of the pregnancy, so that the nausea, vomiting have then come down by then, because iron can sometimes give you a little bit of gastritis, acidity, and it can also promote constipation. So it's important to be well hydrated, and it's important to have a good amount of fiber in your diet when you are starting your iron supplements. So this is about what all we should take. Now, there are certain vitamins that you should not take during pregnancy, and it's very important that we know about these, because if we only know, only then we will not take this vitamin. So an important one among that is vitamin A. Vitamin A is found in a large quantity in liver, which is animal derived, and there are even certain creams and all of that is sometimes prescribed for skin conditions unknowingly that there is a pregnancy. Now vitamin A, when it is taken more than 700 micrograms per day, can start to have toxic effects. So ideally we would want you to avoid from sources that are very, very high in vitamin A. Vitamin E, again, we do not recommend routine supplementation. have a topical use if you wish, but supplementation with vitamin E capsules we normally don't recommend during pregnancy. You could take vitamin B complex supplements if you feel your diet is not able to completely provide you with these vitamins, but most of the times on our kind of diets you would be okay with your vitamin B complex supplements. Without the supplements you could be fine, just the diet could take care of your vitamin B, because you take adequate quantity grains, seeds, nuts, all of this, you will be fine with your B complex. So you need not necessarily take B complex supplements. If you do want to take it, it's not a problem, because an excess of vitamin B, B is going to get eliminated from the body anyway. It is not the body stores. Vitamin K, E, A and D stored in the body. So we do not want to give it to you in an excess, and which is why we are a little reluctant to give you these if the need is not there. Now coming to what you should eat, what you should not eat. So what you must avoid is, first of all, as we said, liver, because it has a high quantity of vitamin A in it. Another kind of element which is sometimes found, which is mercury. So there are certain fishes that have a high quantity of mercury in them, and we would not want you to take these fishes during pregnancy. To name those fishes, they are salmon and mackerel. I'm sorry, I'm not a non-vegetarian, so I would not know a lot about these, but salmon, mackerel are, we want to avoid them as far as possible, or restrict their intake to 1 to 2 times per week. Thing that you need to avoid. The other thing you should avoid is peanuts if you're allergic to it, but if you're not allergic, you can go ahead and have your peanuts. That's not a problem. There are also certain food infections that become very important during pregnancy, and because that is something to do with eating, I'm covering it in the pregnancy diet changes. Now, most important one amongst them is something called as listeriosis. Now, it's present in dairy because it's cold, let's say ice creams, cheese are not ripe. So you have these soft variety of cheeses which are not, you know, fully ripe. These cheeses could have this bacteria called as listeriosis, and in pregnancy that can cause a lot of problem. So you want to stay away from that as far as possible. You can have the routine, like the ones you get, the Amul cheese and other hard cheese that you get in the market, you could easily go ahead and consume it. It is in fact good, but stay away from the Brie, the Camembert and other those soft cheeses that you get in some certain exotic stores. You won't get it everywhere in India. So normal cheese that you get in India, you can go ahead and have, but the exotic cheeses, be careful. The other infection we need to watch out for is Salmonella. In common terms, we call it. So typhoid is again something that is a food and waterborne infection. So you must be careful that you wash your hands, you have adequate hand hygiene, you're not going out and eating cold, you know, foods. Try and, if you're eating out, of course during Corona now we are left with not much choice in terms of eating out, which is a good thing. But even at home, make sure that you're followed when you're cooking. When you visit the toilet, make sure you wash your hands. I know this is something that you will feel that why does a doctor have to tell us about this, but sometimes we do overlook these small bits of hygiene that we should be taking care of, especially if you have a cook at home. She may not be, or he may not be, you know, that hygiene conscious. So it's important that if you have a cook, make sure that you know, he's taking due hygiene precautions. And the last one is toxoplasmosis. Toxoplasma is also a small organism that is normally present in cat litter. So the poop of cats normally has toxoplasmosis, and that can cause a dangerous infection in pregnancy. Toxoplasma can also have damaging effects for the developing baby. Be very careful when we are touching soil, when ground, when you're touching, in Hindi I'll use the term mitti, anything to do with your ground. If you are a, you know, you love to do gardening, make sure that you wear your gloves, thick plastic gloves when you're gardening, and make sure if you have a cat at home that you take care of the disposal of litter. Wear a mask, wear gloves when you're dealing with your cat's poop, or for that matter, even if you have a dog and you're having to clean dog poop, make sure that you're taking all the due precautions. The other very important that make sure that you have food that is properly cooked. So having food that is undercooked, undercooked meat, undercooked vegetables can all cause infections. There's an infection called neurocysticercosis that can happen if you're having raw salad and those salad leaves have not been washed properly. This can cause many other problems. So make sure that you're cooking your well, especially when you're pregnant. You're cooking eggs to hard boil, not having those half cooked eggs. So none of the half cooked or semi cooked food you should be consuming, including steaks and other non-vegetarian food products that you sometimes enjoy, rarely done. Don't do that. So what are the things that we should include in our diet during pregnancy? So the first and most important the myth that I would like to break there is that do eat for two. The other, you are one part of you, which you are eating another individual's food for, is just about, not even about 100 grams in the initial couple of months. So don't start eating for two. Very importantly, eat how you eat. Try and include at least 5 portions of fresh fruits or vegetables in your diet. So that gives you all the minerals, vitamins, and it also gives you a lot of roughage and hydration. Whatever seasonal fruits and vegetables are available, try and have them, because they all are loaded with nutrition and all are loaded with factors that can boost your immunity. Now, make sure that 50% of your diet is comprising of carbohydrates, which have whole grains in them. Make sure that you're having whole wheat products, seeds, nuts. If you're having dry fruits, that gives you supplements with something called as omega supplements. So you don't need a tablet for omega. You can just have a handful of dry fruits, maybe in the morning, maybe in the evening. That doesn't really matter. The other important component is protein. Protein is a very important nutrition factor during pregnancy, because proteins are basically the building blocks of our body. So if you're building a new human being inside you, you must, isn't it? So you take, if you weigh, say, let's say 60 kg, you should take around 60 grams of protein. So it is 1 gram of protein per kg of weight. In pregnancy, you could even go ahead and take a little more protein. Protein sources for vegetarians are dals, pulses, seeds, lentils, what else? Broccoli. There are certain vegetables that are high in protein. So it could be broccoli. It could be, dairy products, which are low fat, but high in protein. So when you're having milk, it's going to give you protein and it's going to give you, but make sure you have the low fat variety. Otherwise, along with these two helpful components, you also get a lot of extra dose of fat in it. So do that. Don't, in India, you know, we have this custom where we tend to eat a lot of ghee during pregnancy. Now that is not required. We do not live in a day and a time where we used to do, we are needed to do a lot of physical work. So we fields, we don't plow the fields, we don't walk for kilometers from one place to the other like we used to do earlier in villages. Everything happens with a click of finger, and therefore overnutrition is one of the biggest problems in not only our country but everywhere else in the world. So overnutrition, excess of fat in your diet is something that you need to steer clear of. Caffeine, if you're a coffee lover, make more than 2 cups of coffee in a day. 200 milligrams per day is what we assume, that it's around 100 milligrams of coffee per cup. So, two. And watch out, it's not just coffee that gives you caffeine. Caffeine is also present in teas. It is present in colas. It's present in chocolate. So make sure that when you're, looking at caffeine, it's not just coffee that needs to be incriminated. And no extra calories are required during almost the first 4-5 months of pregnancy. It's only in the later time that you need somewhere around 200 to 300 calories extra, which is equivalent to pieces of bread. And we I'm sure are used to eating a whole lot more. So we need to avoid doing that. So let's see, I think I've covered everything. Again, the healthy things: stay away from fried food, away from unhealthy food, try and eat as much as possible at home, meals that are hot, that are nutritious. Whenever you're putting something in your mouth, think about the nutritious value that you're giving yourself. Because remember, when you're doing that in pregnancy, you're not feeding just yourself, but you're feeding your baby too. So to all those prospective mothers, I know that that feeling of maternity would have kicked in the moment you would have seen the positive pregnancy test. And so to those mothers, next time you put something in your mouth and you're pregnant, think if it's going to be something that you're going to allow your baby to have when it's born. So if you're not going to give your baby colas, if you're not going to give him a sugary food, oily food, fried food, then it makes sense to not give it to yourself when you're pregnant. This is also, I think, you know, I take it as a part of the garbh sanskar itself, that you're not making the baby used to these things even before he or she is born. So these are just some of the myths that are associated with nutrition in pregnancy. I hope that you've all understood something. I hope that you've all had some benefit from this video. If you are pregnant and you're looking for personalized diet counseling, you could message me on Facebook. I'll make sure that we get a dietitian customized plan to you. I aspire that by these videos, all the pregnant are able to have a balanced diet, a nutritious diet, and are able to have healthy babies. Our next segment is going to be on obesity, high weight in pregnancy. What are the effects and we can do to take care of it, and how the care in pregnancy will change if you're on the higher side of the scale pregnancy. So I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you so much. Do get back to me if you have any further queries. Thanks a lot, guys. Bye.